ऑफिस बेयरर्स एंड मेंबर्स ऑफ द अखिल भारतीय अधिवक्ता परिषद, लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन. इट इज अ मैटर ऑफ ग्रेट सैटिस्फैक्शन दैट द अखिल भारतीय अधिवक्ता परिषद इज स्टार्टिंग द देवी अहिल्या बाई होलकर लेक्चर सीरीज. द सेम कमेमोरेट्स द मेमोरी ऑफ वन ऑफ द फाइनेस्ट रूलर्स ऑफ इंडिया whose reign saw a happy and a prosperous period for her subjects. The fact that she was a lady only adds to her stature and goes on to show what women can achieve by sheer grit and determination. The topic for today's deliberation, role of the legal system as custodian of women's rights, is apt in today's day and age when the women of the country are marching forward in their quest for equality in all spheres of society and are fulfilling their aims and aspirations. It is said that sexism and discrimination are as old as the human race, and women have been suffering on these counts for centuries. However, history is also replete with examples of women who have fought against a vested patriarchal system, and their efforts have benefited the entire womankind. Maya Angelou, the famous American poet, had said, "Each time a woman stands for herself, she stands for all women, and the benefits of which are available to womankind, not only in the country, but all over the world." Even prior to the independence of the country, due to the efforts of far-sighted persons, reforms were brought about to protect women and grant them their rights and to free them from the shackles of customary laws which had been made in a patriarchal system. The demand for a uniform civil code dates back to the colonial period in India. The customary law discriminated against women by depriving them of inheritance, custody of children, remarriage, divorce. Reform of local, social, and religious customs were made. Justice Mehta referred to the Bengal Sati Regulation Act, which was thereafter extended to India, is one of the prime examples of how a vested system which was completely anti-women was fought and successfully. Efforts of the social reformers led to activation of the legislative process for outlawing regressive customs by statutory enactments. The Indian Succession Act of 1865 was one of the first laws to ensure women's economic security and attempted to shift the personal laws to the realm of civil law from religious customary practices. The Hindu Widow Remarriage Act, the Indian Marriage Act, the Special Marriage Act were efforts of reform which granted far greater rights to women than traditional customary laws. Subsequent enactments like Married Women's Property Act of 1923, the Hindu Inheritance Removal of Disabilities Act, the Hindu Women's Right to Property Act of 1937, recognized a Hindu woman's right to property, which led to economic empowerment of women. I would refer to Justice Mehta's views, where she has rightly said that economic empowerment is the need of the hour, as that is what will enable women really to fight the shackles in which a patriarchal system seeks to place them. With the independence of the country, the Constituent Assembly, tasked with the framing of the country's constitution, was fully alive to the needs of the women of India and took care to ensure that the constitution protects and furthers their interests. the Indian Constitution through the fundamental rights, the fundamental duties, and directive principles guarantees equal rights to all citizens and equal protection of laws, which includes all women in the country. In fact, there are several provisions in the Constitution that embody the spirit of gender equality and lay the ground for framing policies, mechanisms, safeguards, and programs and policies for the protection, and more importantly, empowerment of women in the country. The Indian Constitution upholds women's rights through the right to equality, the right to live with dignity, and the right to freedom from discrimination. Whereas Article 14 grants to every person, which includes women, equality before the law and equal protection of laws, Article 16 mandates equality of opportunity to all citizens, including women, in matters relating to employment or appointment to any office under the state. However, one of the articles which, according to me, is the most important article for women empowerment is Article 15, subclause 3, which enables a state legislature or parliament to make special laws and provisions for the benefit of women, which is not only to protect the rights of the women, but to grant them such special favors as may be required to enable them to compete on equal terms with the men. Similarly, the directive principles, particularly Article 39, provides that the state direct its policy towards securing that all citizens, and it specifically uses the word men and women equally, have the right to an adequate means of livelihood. This only shows that the framers of the Constitution were fully aware of the needs of women and had the foresight to lay down such principles in the Constitution, acting on which the state legislatures would thereafter go on to make such laws, which would be for the benefit and empowerment of women. They also made a provision for adequate protection and provision of an equal share in the country's wealth, assets, resources, and opportunities for women so that they can attain their due place in society. Thereafter, as Justice Mehta very rightly referred to, even when amendments were made to the Constitution, the rights of women were furthered by reservation of seats in panchayats and local bodies for women, which also provides for reservation in the offices of chairpersons in the panchayats, which is necessary to ensure that women at the grassroots level are involved in the formulation of policy and implementation of the same. The makers of the Constitution were fully aware and conscious to the needs of women. And the vision of the makers of the Constitution was duly given effect to by the legislatures of the Union and the states, which from time to time have enacted various laws for the protection of women and for advancement of their interests. The first of such expressions were the reforms of the Hindu law in 1956 by enactment of the Hindu Marriage Act, the Hindu Succession Act, the Minority and Guardianship Act, and the Hindu Adoptions and Maintenance Act. It freed a large segment of India's population, namely women, from the restrictions of religion-based laws and customs, which, as I had stated earlier, having been made by a patriarchal system, were all geared to keep women under subjugation. These laws were the first steps in emancipation of the women and their empowerment against a patriarchal society and a patriarchal order. Thereafter, as time progressed, women-centric laws addressing the concerns of women were passed. As Justice Mehta very rightly referred, that there is a need to do further. And she also referred for the need of education. It becomes imperative for all of us to ensure that knowledge about the laws and provisions which protect women and their rights have to be spread so that not only women can use their protective measures for their personal safety, but also for their advancement. As a parent, as a wife, a daughter, employee, and a woman, these are rights set in place to protect you, and it is important that everybody is aware about them. I would refer to some of them during the course of my discussion and also the interpretations placed by the honorable courts. One of the most important steps was the setting up of the National Commission for Women in the year 1990. It being a statutory body which represents the rights of women in India and provides a voice for their issues and concerns. It aims to improve the status of women and has worked for their economic empowerment. Economic empowerment, according to me, would be the most important step after education to enable women to stand on their own and be able to fight a patriarchal system which seeks their subjugation. The Constitution framers were fully aware of this and provided in Article 39D that there shall be equality of pay amongst men and women. The same was given effect to by the Equal Remuneration Act of 1976, which prevents discrimination in terms of remuneration, salary, pay, or wages. Working women have the right to draw an equal salary as compared to men, besides enjoying all other employment benefits as are available to men. And I'm happy to say that there are many other laws, provisions, and policies which are granting extra benefit to women, which is the need of the hour. Two examples which stand out in the implementation of this is the famous case of the air hostesses, as referred to by Justice Mehta, which struck the very basis of discrimination of women, which was entirely based upon their sex, of their being women, and had no other basis. The same was struck down by the Supreme Court. Thereafter, very recently, the Supreme Court has also held that all women army officers are eligible for permanent commissions, thus permitting them to be in commanding roles. Women officers are now on par with their male counterpart when it comes to promotions, ranks, benefits, pensions, fortifying their position in the defense sector. The argument which was put forward by the state that such jobs may not be safe for them has been negated by the court, which has acknowledged the ability and the capability of the women of this country to perform the most arduous tasks. While we are on the issue relating to employment, women have the right against harassment at the workplace. And this is a classic case where judicial activism in favor of women has led to legislation. The Supreme Court in Vishakha versus State of Rajasthan laid down guidelines and mechanism for the redressal of grievances of the employees. These guidelines were eventually formalized as legislation a vital law to protect millions of women who enter the country's workforce every year. The basis of the Supreme Court decision was the unfortunate sexual assault on a social worker, a Sathin in Rajasthan, who was working with the state government to prevent child marriages, and was a classic example as to how vested interests could go to any length to subjugate women. On the prodding of the Supreme Court that a suitable law should be made where it would be the duty of the employer and other responsible persons in workplaces and other institutions to prevent sexual harassment. And the Supreme Court also went to define sexual harassment in very wide terms, which have been adopted in the Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Act to ensure their safety at the workplace and to protect them from sexual harassment. The wide definition would includes the use of language, sexual overtones, invasion of private space, subtle touches and innuendos, promise of preferential detrimental treatment in employment, threat about the present or future employment, status, creating a hostile, intimidating, or offensive work environment are all included in the definition of workplace. The aim being that there should be no discrimination, there should be no harassment by explicit or implicit means. Under the Factories Act, there are specific provisions. Under the Shops and Establishment Act, there are special provisions for separate restrooms, toilets to be provided for women. The unfortunate part is that despite these provisions, many a times, the provisions of these statutes were used not to further the cause of women, but the state sought to justify its action of discrimination on the ground that it is seeking to protect the rights of the women. In a landmark judgment authored by Justice S.P. Sinha relating to the working hours and late night duties by women, it was held by the Honorable Supreme Court that it is the duty of the state to ensure that law and order is maintained to enable women to work in all such occupations and at all times as they desire. And the plea of their safety cannot be used as an excuse to deny them these rights. The recent judgment of the Supreme Court in the case of the dance bars in Maharashtra, where the law was interpreted by the Supreme Court to say that these dance bars would remain open, struck at a legislative measure which, under the cover of protecting women's rights, was actually leading to unemployment of thousands of women. This is another example of the courts coming forward to protect the right of women to employment of their choice. Amongst other provisions which have been made is the Maternity Benefit Act, which regulates the employment of women and maternity benefits. Every woman is entitled to receive maternity benefits, which includes maternity leave, nursing breaks, medical allowance. The legislative intent has also been furthered by government policy, as now there is a provision of childcare leave in government employment to enable women to look after their young children. And while I'm on this, according to me, these, though ostensibly may seem to be women-centric laws, are actually society-centric laws. They further the concept of a family, and a family belongs both to the man and the woman. The reference to these statutes by me is also being made because the legal system is not just the judicial system. The legislative system is as much a part of the legal system, because the courts will interpret the laws which are made by the legislature. And many a times the court decisions also egg the legislature on. Having made various provisions for economic empowerment of women, the laws of the country are fully sensitive to the personal safety of the women. And some of the provisions, like the right of women against being stalked, has seen an amendment where the provisions of the erstwhile Section 354 in the Indian Penal Code have been expanded. And any act, subtle or otherwise, which will include trying to establish unwilling contact, physically or in any other form of electronic communication, physical contact, demand for favors, or any unwelcome physical, verbal, or non-verbal conduct, which would tend to outrage the modesty of a woman, has been made punishable and the punishments stand enhanced. It will be apt here to mention that even in customary law, modesty was an attribute of great rectitude and integrity of the woman, which has been accepted and furthered by the statutory legislations which have been enacted. One very unfortunate incident had happened in this country about 8 to 9 years back, which we all refer to as the Nirbhay rape incident, which led to the Criminal Law Amendment Act, where the law was made far more stringent. It provides for the information for sexual offenses to be recorded by a woman officer. The victim is now entitled to be represented by a lawyer from the beginning of the case. The doctors and medical staff have been directed that they should cater to the medical needs of the victim with utmost priority. No hospital can deny conducting medical legal checkup of any victim who has come to the hospital without police referral. But more importantly, to ensure her privacy and that the privacy of a woman is protected, a woman who has been sexually assaulted may record her statement alone before the district magistrate when the case is under trial or in the presence of a female police officer. Prior to that, Section 114A of the Evidence Act was inserted as an outcome of the infamous Mathura rape case, where judicial intervention led to a legislative amendment being made. The courts have been fully sensitive to the needs of women in this, and the difficulty that a woman who is the subject of sexual assault in forthcoming to disclose everything and to be fighting the system. The courts have gone to the extent to say that the sole testimony of the victim of sexual assault can be the basis of conviction if reliable, thus granting sanctity to the statement of the victim and negating the theory of her being an interested witness. The Honorable Court has further expanded the concept of a sexual assault and has laid down in a number of cases that if the consent of the woman is taken by deception and even on a false promise of marriage or any other false promise, then it would be a void consent in law, and the act of the predator would be punishable as an act of rape. The Honorable Court, while being liberal in laying down guidelines where consent could be the basis of quashing of criminal cases, has categorically held that there can be no mediation and no compromise can be reached with the culprit in cases of rape or attempt to rape, thus preventing the rich and powerful predators from subjugating women on the strength of their money and other powers. The Honorable Supreme Court was also very conscious of the degrading ways in victims of sexual assault were being treated when they were brought for their medical care and medical legal checkup. And therefore, in the matter of Leelu versus State of Haryana in the year 2013, this understanding the agony and trauma of a rape victim who had to go through the two-finger test to give a character certification, the Honorable Court, relying upon a number of precedents in this regard, held that this test is a violation of the victim's right to privacy and dignity. The court held that rape survivors are entitled to legal recourse that does not re-traumatize them or violate their physical or mental integrity and dignity. They also went on to lay down that they are entitled to medical procedures to be conducted in a manner commensurate with their right to dignity, the right to privacy, and with their consent. Medical procedures which were cruel, inhuman, or degrading treatment were frowned upon by the court, and the paramount consideration being a gender-based and a respectful treatment of a victim. On the egging of the court, the law also today now stands amended, where female victims of sexual assault have the right to keep their identity anonymous, and the law prohibits disclosing the name and identity of a woman who is the subject of sexual assault or an act which may outrage her modesty. One of the most important judgments is where a petitioner, a rape survivor, who wished to remain unidentified, had approached the Honorable Supreme Court seeking permission to abort her 24-week abnormal fetus. And there was a challenge to the 46-year-old Maternal Termination of Pregnancy Act that did not permit abortion of a fetus after 20 weeks. The Supreme Court, keeping in view the agony of a victim of sexual assault, ruled in favor of the petitioner after the medical board submitted that continuing with the pregnancy would put the mother's life at risk. So as we see, with passage of time, the loopholes in the law relating to sexual assault are being filled up both by judicial interpretation and also by legislative enactments. Where the judiciary has played an important role is in the case of acid attack victims. A number of young women are subjected to acid attacks by young men who have scores to settle with them. In Lakshmi versus Union of India, which is a landmark case of proactive judicial activism, on a petition filed by a victim of an acid attack, taking cognizance of the number of cases relating to acid attacks against women being on the rise, the Supreme Court imposed stringent regulations on the sale of acid in the year 2013. The ruling banned over-the-counter sale of acid. Dealers could sell acid only if the buyer provided a vital valid identity proof. It was mandatory for the dealer to submit details, and it made illegal to sell acid to a person below 18 years. On the prodding of the court, the legislature also moved in and made the provisions of Section 326 A and B more stringent. The first time a concept of imposition of a fine on a accused, which was to be paid to the victim, was introduced. And under this section, any fine which was imposed would be paid to the victim. Further, compensation for acid attack victims was brought in by the addition of Section 357B, and a minimum compensation of rupees 3 lakhs was to be given to every acid attack victim. This compensation was in addition to the fine which was to be imposed on a person who's held guilty and punished. Section 357 was inserted, mandating that all hospitals, public and private, are required to provide first aid. One important decision which has taken place, though it is not on the judicial or the legislative side, but it is emanating from the National Legal Services Authority, which is headed by the first puni judge of the Honorable Supreme Court, which has framed a policy of grant of compensation to victims of physical assaults, attacks, rapes, acid attacks, and amounts ranging from rupees 1 lakh to 10 lakh have been provided. And the Honorable Supreme Court has clarified that this scheme is to be used as guidelines by special courts in awarding compensation to minor victims till the central government prepares rules. This act of the Honorable Supreme Court is filling in the gaps in the legislation and working proactively for the protection of women and advancement of their interests. A unfortunate thing in this country has been the dowry deaths, which is nothing else but a patriarchal system which has been practiced for a long duration of time. Many of these provisions have been now made far more stringent, and the Honorable Supreme Court has also now, in the matter of Lata Singh versus State of Uttar Pradesh, gone on to say that not only dowry deaths would be punished, but even honor killings is something which is abhorrent to the rights of a woman to choose a life partner. The Honorable Court in Shakti Vaini versus Union of India has further ruled against Khap panchayats and assemblies of village elders to interfere with the marriage between two consenting adults. Importantly, in all these cases, the court which had propounded the concept of a zero FIR so that there would be no delay in starting the process of investigation applied them to all victims of assaults of a sexual nature. And the legislature has also now stepped in to provide for the zero FIR. Another important aspect is domestic violence to which a woman is subjected in this country. And as Justice Mehta very rightly pointed out, the Supreme Court in a recent judgment has categorically held that the shared household would be the matrimonial house where the woman has been residing. The Domestic Violence Act has been held by the Supreme Court in SC Ahuja versus Sneha Ahuja, the recent judgment, as a milestone against offenses which are rampant in the nature of domestic violence in this country. The court acknowledging that women face violence in some form or the other almost every day. And the woman has to resign to a fate of a never-ending cycle. The protection was granted because the court was of the opinion that domestic violence are cases which are never reported due to social stigma and attitude of women themselves. The earlier view of a restrictive interpretation was set aside and disagreed by the court. Another landmark case is Dhanulal and others versus Ganesh Ram in the year 2015. Where to prevent exploitation of women who've been living together under the same roof in a continuous cohabitation as a couple, even though there was no formalization of marriage, the court granted the benefit of such a woman also to all rights to property. Reference has already been made by Justice Mehta to the judgment in Vinita Sharma versus Rakesh Sharma, which has expanded the rights of women to HUF property and granted them co-personary rights. I will not detail. But more importantly, the Delhi High Court, in a very landmark judgment after this enactment, had held that if a male member of a Hindu undivided family, by virtue of his being the firstborn eldest, can be the Kalta, so can a female member be. It is an acknowledgement of the capability of women to be performing all duties for the benefit of the family, which any man could do. Needless to mention, the Supreme Court, for a very long duration of time, has ruled that a woman can claim her istridhan from her husband and family, even if they are not divorced, and women can claim istridhan even after the separation. So the woman's right to a istridhan has been accepted as the absolute right. These cases are not limited only to the Hindu religion. In Mary Roy versus State of Kerala, the Supreme Court delivered a landmark judgment that granted Syrian Christian women the right to seek an equal share in their father's property, overruling the customary law. Reference has been made by the speakers before me to the case of Shaira Banu, which is the triple talaq case. In a very heartening departure from its earlier view in Muhammad Ahmad versus Shah Banu, which granted limited relief by taking a conservative approach, the Honorable Supreme Court in the triple talaq case has held it to be against the basic tenets of the Quran. But more importantly, it had urged the legislature to pass a law which led to the Muslim Women Protection of Rights of Marriage Act, which has not only outlawed the practice, but also made it a punishable offense. The Supreme Court has also called for a reassessment of the Muslim Women Act of 86, which requires a Muslim man to pay maintenance only during the period of iddat. These are cases where the courts of the country, alive to the needs of women, have come forward to protect their interest. Justice Mehta has already referred to the Geeta Hariharan matter. In a related development, the Supreme Court, in a landmark judgment, has held that an unwed mother belonging to the Christian faith is not bound to disclose the name of the child's father. By an act of the executive, today when forms are filled up for admission to educational institutions and other things like passports and all, the name of the mother has also to be put forth. Justice Mehta had also referred to the Sabrimala view. I will not detail this. But more importantly, in a similar case relating to Muslims, on the prodding of the court, the All India Muslim Personal Law Board has filed an affidavit in the Supreme Court stating that the entry of women in mosques is allowed as per Islam, which is a huge departure from the conservative practice which has been going on for a considerable duration of time. Justice Mehta also referred to the right of dignity and decency and freedom from obscenity. Number of acts are there. Importantly, in state of Tamil Nadu versus Suhaskutti led to the first conviction where a victim was harassed by sending defamatory and obscene messages on her online account. This is the first case where an online stalking has been taken note of by the courts and the accused has been punished. The Honorable Supreme Court, in the matter of Sehat versus Union of India, has also directed and monitored the implementation of the Prenatal Sex Determination Act and the techniques, which is another woman-friendly provision whose strict implementation is being monitored by the Supreme Court. But one of the judgments which I consider as the most landmark judgment, which upholds the rights and dignity of women, is the judgment which held Section 497 of the Indian Penal Code as unconstitutional. If one were to see the debates which led to the enactment of this section, where a man was given a right to complain of a sexual misconduct by his wife, the reason given was that a married woman was nothing more than the property of her husband. Such a thing would be a shame in today's day and age. A woman is an equal partner, and the Supreme Court, relying on her right to equality, struck down the said provision in Joseph Shine versus the Union of India. In addition to these things, there are other provisions under the Legal Services Authorities Act, which has given women who are victims of assault of any nature free legal aid and legal services. There are provisions in law where a woman cannot be arrested at night, where she cannot be arrested by a male officer. She cannot be interrogated if there is no woman constable or family members and friends are not present. Women have been given the right to register virtual complaints. Such cases are legion, and if one were to list all of them, it would require a huge amount of time. There is paucity of time, but I would like to conclude by saying that the Indian judiciary has always played a crucial role in framing and interpreting laws that uphold women's rights and dignity in India. The Supreme Court has played a constructive role in development of rights and jurisprudence and expanding the progressive, libertarian, and democratic values. The influence of the court in public consciousness is no longer confined to its position as a final arbiter. The Supreme Court has often responded to the needs by mobilization of rights groups and civil society, egging on the liberal thought, egging on the legislature to do its part, and has delivered a number of judgments which have upheld the rights of the women, particularly their right to live in this country with dignity. Having said that, I completely agree with Justice Mehta that though we have traversed a long distance in our journey, we still have a long way to go. And therefore, it is imperative that a national narrative be developed on the social front to educate women about their rights, and at the same time to sensitize people about the rights of women and the need to respect the law. I would conclude by referring to a statement made by Justice Sandra Day O'Connor, the first judge of the US Supreme, first lady judge of the Supreme Court, where speaking on an occasion when the achievements of women were being listed, she said, "I am waiting for that day where the achievements are so numerous that we cannot count them anymore. They should be beyond count. I sincerely hope that such a day comes in this country also." Thank you. Dhanyavaad.
Dhanyavaad, sir.